Before any of that Jody read, I was a gardener. And I'm just curious, how many of you outside of your professional world take the time to garden at home? Ooh, that's a lot of you. Okay. So I was struck by something that Lori said before, and that was all those tributaries are connected. You were talking about a drainage ditch, but let's think of our gardens as tributaries being connected. And that's why I want to talk about being a good neighbor. Your landscape, your backyard, as part of this whole pollinator support picture. Can you hear me in the back? Because I think I'm okay, good. So you've seen these numbers a couple of times today, and they vary a little bit, I think. But all those backyard beekeepers are out there, and their numbers are rising. There's about 477 solitary and social wild bee species. And I got some of that information from the New York Biodiversity site. And you check it out. There's a nice little summary there. And they are nesting in cavities, digging tunnels in soil, in wood, or using hollow plant stems in our backyards, in our landscapes. So how do we be a good neighbor? And people want to be good neighbors. They say they want to be good neighbors. Let's try that. Do I have to be?
It did it.
Okay. So people really have good intentions. And an interesting study I read, I wish. They asked gardeners in neighborhoods, well, do they want to support wildlife? And who would say no to that? Of course you want to support wildlife, right? And they did. They wanted to. But then when they presented them with photographs, kind of a continuum of what a landscape would look like if it supported wildlife, and they didn't tell them which to pick, they always picked this one. Why did they pick it? Well, we're really social animals. We belong to a group, and that's what makes us cohesive as a culture. So we are picking things that adhere to a borrowed landscape ideal, and one that may not really be especially adapted to our environment. So we may be having more inputs in there in terms of fertilizer, in terms of water, in terms of pest controls. But it falls within our cultural norms. We feel good about that. So that's one thing that came up as they were doing this research. There was also another interesting kind of byline that I ran across as I was doing my master's work. It was that people, our current response to a pest problem is kind of a fire extinguisher pest response. We see a problem, and we get that fire extinguisher, and we extinguish the problem, okay? So, and where do we get that good advice? Well, we get it from our family members and our peers, right? Because they're experts. Well, that's often where we do get our advice, and they're not really experts. The other issue is that people don't have a lot of time, and they go to the store, they pick something up off the shelf, they may not even ask for advice, they grab it, they go, and they spray. They don't have time to do the research and look at other options. So we have a couple of things here warring together. IPM strategies may be very different from what is familiar to them. It requires them to kind of stop and observe and repeat and keep doing that. What is it? You know, why is it there? What is it doing? Is it really a pest, or does it just look sinister and I want to spray it with something, right? Yeah, so we got a long way to go on doing some public relations for insects, I think. So they also have to decide how much damage they can live with, and that's more thinking. Then they have to devise a control strategy that they can feel good about. And then would really love it if they then went ahead and shared that knowledge or told their neighbors about what they've discovered, what they've learned about a particular pest. Because chances are, if you're having trouble with it and their neighbors have the same issue, they can learn something from you. So that's really different than going out there and just grabbing that bottle of pesticides and swatting down the problem. And the alternatives may be at odds with social norms. And gardens that don't look tidy often are equated with lower property values. And people, in a couple other studies, one of the things that reasons they gave for having their landscapes look like their neighbors is they wanted to protect property values. They didn't want to be the one who got the little summons or their citation from the town that said, mow your front lawn. Well, there's some ideas around that you might like. When you're creating a space that is a haven for pollinators, you're providing food sources. We've heard a lot of that today. You're providing also layered structure, things like debris, again, not very tidy, but really important in terms of those insects that are looking for cavities and wood to nest in. If we really tidily clean up that landscape, they don't have that opportunity to find that kind of structure. While you're doing all of that, as you heard just before, you can increase beneficial organisms in that landscape. You may also have a few more pest species in that landscape as well. And then when you use pesticides knowledgeably in that situation, you may then be conscious of the effect of those pesticides on all of those beneficial organisms. So we're asking a lot of people who really don't have a lot of time and come home and they just want to, what did Mark say before, rent a video instead, right? So landscapes like this, though, can provide beauty and value to your homes, to your neighborhoods. And how do we kind of shift that thinking on a landscape scale? Well, providing cues for care. As one of our master gardeners said to me, make it look deliberate. If it looks like you meant it to happen, people will think, oh, this is supposed to be beautiful. Do you ever have that happen to you when you go to see modern art? Okay. So again, you're sort of trying to fool your neighbors, but you're also fooling yourself, because when you make it look deliberate, when you mow the edges or even put up a sign, you're persuading yourself just as much as you're persuading your neighbors. When you make it public, you start to make a commitment to it. If you make a commitment to it, you'll be more likely to permanently adopt that behavior. Make it public with a sign, and there's many different kinds of signs out there that say, you know, this is a pollinator habitat. It's not a bunch of weeds. And you can tell because I put a little bench here for sitting, or I put a birdhouse in, or I put a garden sculpture or structure, whatever suits your aesthetic, and I've kept the edges mown, or I've kept it in an area that makes it look deliberate and cared for. So include those cues for care. Then also, when you're providing safe harbor, and I've heard many speakers talk about this today, you really do need to know your plants, you need to know your pests, and know your options. And perhaps your family member or your neighbors aren't the best way to get that. And I think that's often what happens. People really don't know what it is that they're dealing with. There's wonderful master gardeners out there with horticulture hotlines. Here's your local cooperative extension. They're there just to answer those questions, and they want you to call them. So when you decide to treat, consider the foraging habits of insects, and think about inoculating or introducing biocontrols before you have a problem. And there again, you really need to know your plant, your pest, and your options. So it's a long trip. We've got a lot of education to do, because these alternatives are often really at odds with cultural norms. And you should be brave and delve right into this. I'm sorry, I couldn't see how many times I could use B in there. That a different aesthetic that includes cues that are familiar, cues from the past, cues that the landscape is cared for, can be beautiful, okay? And then on the other side, on the right, I think somebody else used the same exact photograph earlier today. But considering beneficial insects as well, many of the people who are out there gardening would see something like this little fly larvae and think it is a sinister beast, okay? And that happens all the time. I think even, you know, we were talking before us at lunchtime about how, you know, butterflies are really easy for people to wrap their heads around, right? They're beautiful. Bees, ooh. Then you get into wasps and hornets, which do a lot of wonderful things in our landscape. They're not interested. And because they really don't know the difference between bees and wasps and hornets, you throw the baby out with the bathwater. You don't want any of them. When we had a pollinator presentation this past summer, people basically said, well, why would you want to encourage bees? right? So we have a long way to go in terms of people opening their hearts to fuzzy insects. So we'll see what we can do. I think I might bring us back right on schedule here if I keep talking this fast. So there's a bunch of websites that were mentioned today. There's a Be a Good Neighbor fact sheet that, Jody, I think you had that out in the back before, but it is online. And that I copied right off the internet, so I know that that link works. Cooperative Extension offices, instead of getting advice from your dad or your neighbor or the guy who dumps a gallon of gasoline down the yellow jacket hole and then puts a match in there, call your Cooperative Extension and talk to Master Gardener volunteers. I know we have a lot in the room, and they really love researching for you and finding really good options and identifying things. Is it really a bad bug or not? And that's a really hard question to ask, because people really just want to know, should I kill it? Then lists of plants hospitable to pollinators. There's so many out there to look for. There are just, the first one is a book called Attracting Native Pollinators. It's, and don't drop it on your toe, it's a serious book. It's a nice big volume with a lot of beautiful photographs in it too. And then, did somebody already mention Pollinator Partnership today? I lost track. We had a lot of good websites today, yeah. That's a different Pollinator Partnership. Sorry. And I tried to join your... Oh, okay. Well, I tried your Twitter thing. I didn't get to attach. So maybe you could... it was at...
N-E-Pollinator.
N-E-Pollinator. Okay. Yeah. All right, I'll go look for it again. So. Okay. Yeah. Yes. So actually, I went through that really fast. So that's okay, because we're going to sit around here and we're going to answer some questions, because I have some too. Thanks. Oh.